living longer, living healthier, living better than ever before. Welcome to Mountain Pacific's Healthy Living for Life, a weekly series that gives you the information, education, and expert insight you need to become an active participant in today's ever-changing healthcare climate. Here now is today's program host.
Investing time and money into estate planning will not only protect your loved ones, but will also ensure your wishes are carried out after you're gone or if you're unable to communicate for yourself. If you own property and assets, estate planning is important to your peace of mind and financial security, regardless of your age. Welcome to Healthy Living for Life, a show dedicated to helping you do just that. I'm Lisa Sather, your host. Today we're going to talk about estate planning and trusts. Stay tuned. Welcome back to Healthy Living for Life. Joining us now is Catherine Monroe and Joel Silverman, attorneys from the Silverman Law Office. Joel and Catherine specialize in estate planning, trusts, and estate administration. Thanks for joining us today.
Thank you, Lisa.
Thank you. So Catherine, first off, let's start out with you. And could you talk a little bit about why estate planning is important for folks?
It's very important, and a lot of people think that they don't have any wealth, and so they're just gonna not plan anything. In fact, there are a lot of people who are millionaires out there, and they don't know it. But if, for example, if you have a house that's worth $350,000, if you have some IRAs that are worth $450,000, and some investments and vehicles of any kind, then you're a millionaire, and you really should plan. So property is a function of state law, and each state has a system that if you don't have a will, then they will tell you how your property is going to go down to the next generation. And if you're happy with that plan that the state has, then you don't have to do anything. But if you don't like the state plan, you need to get a will and do some planning for yourself. And it's important too for avoiding probate. If you don't want to go through the probate process, which is a process of transferring property through the court system, then you need to plan something so that it avoids that.
Excellent. So when we talk about estate planning, what exactly does that entail? Maybe Joel, to you.
Yeah, Lisa. Well, it's really important that for our families that we set things up so that they're taken care of. And estate planning is the key to making that happen. So it's protecting what we've built through our entire lives and protecting our children. Because what we don't want to do is potentially, in Kathy's example, is have our children, who may be very young, inherit a large sum of money. Because life insurance oftentimes is a big key component of our estate planning. And our estate planning brings together all our assets such that we can transfer it either by will, trust, or beneficiary designation, such as a payable on death or a transfer on death designation, and that's usually financial accounts. But so we transfer those to the next generation or to charities.
Excellent, makes complete sense. So let's talk about how estate planning provides protection and certainty for a person's spouse and loved ones. How does that work?
By planning now, you plan while you have capacity, and your plan is written down. So when you pass away or when you get incapacitated, you can be assured that it's written down, people can follow it, and certain people are designated to take certain roles in your estate. If you do have to go to probate, then it's all there. Who's going to handle it and things? Some people think that a court will take your estate and appoint somebody and do run the probate if you're not there, and that's just not real true. Usually the personal representative will go in and put in the file with the court, because the court has to be asked to do something. And so the personal representative will handle all of that. At this point, certainty and stuff is it's written down. You've done it when you have capacity. Everybody knows that it's there. You can also leave a letter of instruction to your people and say, here's my intent in doing this, and this is why I did stuff this way. And then if you set up a trust, if you have something that needs to have long-term oversight, then you can set up a trust, and a trust will do that for you.
Good. All right. When it comes to estate planning, what are the primary documents that we're talking about?
So our primary documents consist of a will, which is directing the personal representative, the person you want to handle your estate and your affairs, to put everything together, wrap everything up for you, and distribute your assets to your beneficiaries. You can have a trust, and that trust can either be revocable or irrevocable, but there also needs to be a will backing up the trust as well. And then we have healthcare power of attorney, which allows underneath HIPAA for anybody to handle your healthcare decisions that you directly list, especially very important if you're incapacitated. Mm-hmm. Then we have a financial power of attorney, which allows somebody to make financial decisions for you if and when that time becomes necessary. And then we have a living will, which is the directive that says that you may not want to be on life support if it's really not necessary for you, if there's no hope of recovery.
So let's talk about probate and why does this happen?
Probate, pardon me, yes. Probate, as we said, is a process through the court, and it will happen if you haven't made a plan whereby you can avoid it.
Okay.
Some estates, you just cannot avoid it. If you have real property in your estate, you have to do some planning in order to not have probate. So it is a process through the court. You cannot file it within 5 days of death, and then you have to have it open for 6 months. But in that time, you publish to the creditors, and you also can liquidate assets. It is a, the purpose of a probate is to allow the creditors to know that the person died so that they can get their claims in and be paid, mm-hmm. and also to get the taxes done. So this federal and state taxes have to be done also in that process.
Okay. We have time for, I think, one last question before the break, and I wanted to quickly talk about, you know, we're going to talk about revocable and irrevocable trusts. Can we, in a minute or so, talk quickly about a revocable trust, what it is and what it's used for?
Absolutely, Lisa. So a revocable trust, or if you're on the East Coast, revocable yeah. trust, that is a trust in which it's, a trust is a lot like a company. It's a standalone entity from yourself, but in reality, a revocable trust is an extension of yourself. It is still just you, and it is a way for you to hold your assets so that at your passing, those assets get transferred to your children without having to go through probate. We can also use a revocable trust to help us plan for things like long-term care, children with special needs, if something happens to us at our passing, to deal with pets, and to deal with other family members as well.
Excellent. All right, we're going to take a quick break, and we'll come back and talk some more. We're going to pause here for a short break, as I mentioned, and we'll continue talking about revocable trusts and what you need to know about them after these messages. And then a little later, we'll tackle irrevocable trusts. Don't go away.